Hey, welcome back to the Office 365 Jumpstart. I'm Adam Carter, joined now by Jeff James. This is the last session of the day. Just a reminder, please stick around until the end of the session and fill out the eval. It's very important for us to make sure there's value for these. Jeff, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself. Tell us what you work on, what you do.
Sure. So as you said, my name is Jeff James. I'm a solution architect, and so I work in actually in the service teams now, so back within the business group that runs Office 365. I've been part of the online services for the last 6.5 years, starting out with the dedicated offerings, moving into BPOS, and then into Office 365. So.
All right, cool. So you've been doing this stuff. How long have you been doing Office 365? And are you sure talking to customers and helping them with architectures?
Been out doing deployments and also helping customers understand whether the cloud is the right move for them at this point in time, how it fits. We've been doing that all through the beta and pre-launch work.
Okay, cool. Well, this is a subject that a lot of people have some interest in, and there seems to be a little bit of confusion around what the offerings are. So I'm going to turn time over to you and let you run with it and demystify all the archiving and compliance stuff that's available.
All right, sounds good. So like this says, we're obviously into Exchange archiving and compliance. Like you said, Adam, it's an archiving is an overloaded term. So we're going to go through a bunch of different aspects of what Microsoft considers archiving, what our customers think archiving is, and then how it fits and plays into the solutions that we have, and really some of the options you have around that. So we're going to start with an overview, talk through some of the terms that we do on and some of the parts of the offering around personal archives and what that means to us. Discovery, how you can actually control mail within both your mailbox and within the archive. We have a bit of information about information rights management, and hopefully we'll wrap this all up in a good solid timeline with and answer some of the questions that people have.
Cool.
So first off, let's talk about this term archive, right? Microsoft looks at it from a number of different perspectives. There's this concept of a PST file and what you've had in traditional Exchange. So that's, in some people's minds, that's an archive, right? Mm-hmm. It's a place where you put your email. It's not your main storage. It's you're archiving it off just like you're taking a file and putting it in a file cabinet.
Right.
There's data retention, so there's regulatory issues, there's people under legal hold, there's all sorts of other compliance issues that come in around how long you retain email, but also how soon you delete it, right? So if you have a governance policy, something that your company has established into what you do in holding on to information, that can all be enforced or at least supported by information tools as well.
Okay.
And then, of course, once you have all these policies and all these tools to preserve email or put it in certain spots or move it from here to there, then you have to have a way to go find where that email went or where that content went. So there's this concept of discovery and how you do that. So those are kind of the general concepts. Some of the challenges we have around archiving email, there's data all over the place. Traditionally, you have stuff in your PST files. You have people who have taken backups and moved them off from their main machine onto a floppy drive or onto a USB drive, a thumb drive, have it on their home machine, all sorts of stuff. So there's information all over the place. There's information in SharePoint sites, there's webmail, there's all this information around what you do. And we're trying to figure, and so what you're trying to do is understand when you need to have discovery against those, when you need to do some research against that, how do you actually go find what's there?
Okay.
So that's kind of our problem space. There's two different ways to look at this. Traditionally, archiving has been an offline type of source. So you take everything that's going on, you make a copy of it, you store it someplace else, and then you hold that and preserve it. Maybe it's immutable storage, it's always there. You find a different way to look at that.
Okay.
Then there's also, on the right-hand side of this slide, you see this concept of archive-enabled applications. So applications that just by their very nature can hold certain amount of content, can hold things in certain places, can allow users to continue their day-to-day activity, but not allow them to get rid of the information that has to be retained. So within Exchange, specifically in Exchange Online, we have a couple different options for this, and we'll talk through this. This slide really sets up the foundation of the rest of our 45 minutes here.
Okay.
So there's this concept of a personal archive. That's a PST file that we put in the cloud. So you have, rather than having your PST file on a local drive or on a network drive within your organization, Exchange Online actually supports this concept of an archive on the cloud. Now you can have that attached to your primary mailbox in the cloud, so you move all of your email up to the cloud. You have a main mailbox and a personal archive up there. Mm-hmm. Or you can have your main mailbox stay on premises but attached to an archive in the cloud. So it gives you a couple options there.
Okay, and can you clarify, because we've seen this, you know, we know we get a 25 gig mailbox, which is exciting.
Right.
Does that archive count against that store?
So part of that depends upon the plan that you're purchasing.
Okay.
So if you have the basic plan, then yes, the archive and the mailbox come out of that same quota. If you have, I believe it's the E3 plan, which adds the enhanced archiving, then you essentially have an unlimited archive that goes there as well. So you can have your primary mailbox, and then you can continue to put information into that archive as well.
It continues to grow. Oh, wow. Okay.
So then the second column over from the left talks about these move and delete policies, which is really an enforcement of the governance that your staff sets up. So either your IT staff or your HR staff or your policy or regulatory people will set up governance around how long you can keep email, how long you have to keep email. There's a couple different things there. And then you can use Exchange Online to actually enforce those policies. Then there's this concept of a hold policy. So someone goes under legal hold,
right.
For whatever reason, lawsuit, injunction, suddenly you can't delete anything that goes back and forth from them. That's
right.
What the legal hold is for. And then over on the far right, you have the concept of discovery, how you go through and search against all these mailboxes and all these different sources. So we talked briefly about this, but as you're looking at your archive in the cloud, there's really three major options for this with the online archive that's part of Exchange Online. So you can go fully hosted, your primary mailbox and your archive are both up in the cloud. That's the top left. The top right is really this cross-premises where you actually have some users with primary and archive on-premises. You have some users with primary and archive in the cloud. You still need that same ability to search across all those different data sources. And then in the bottom, you have this concept of the archive in the cloud. So if you have Exchange on-premises, and it's based on that hybrid model that Naomi just talked to you about, so
okay.
you have to have that Exchange 2010 CAS hub server in order to make that connection. But with that, you can actually put your archive in the cloud as well. So you can continue operating Exchange. Some customers don't see a need for a large mailbox. They have some reason they want to keep Exchange on-premises. They can have that there, they can operate that, keep that running as it is, and then just have this personal archive up in the cloud.
Okay. So a couple of questions that you may be about to address, but let's talk about. Oh, and somebody, I think, answered them and they went away. I lost the questions now. If we delete a mailbox, does the archive go away as well?
So that's a great question. There's one yes, but with some exceptions.
Okay.
Right? So if you have a user under legal hold, when that legal hold, if you don't expire that legal hold, you actually won't be able to delete that account. Because of the function of legal hold, you'll have to retain that information. But if you just have a user who is standard user, everything's there, they're treating that personal archive like an online PSD file, then if you delete that user, the archive will go through the same process the mailbox does.
Okay.
It'll get archived off for a period of 30 days, I believe, and then that other 14-day recycle bin, and then it will be deleted.
Okay. So if we wanted to save that, because we've got some, for whatever process, mm-hmm. It would be a manual process for an administrator to take that account, archive the mail, say to a PSD file, and pull it out of the cloud somehow before deleting the account.
They could do that, or they could just leave that account active but disabled.
Disabled, just
right.
Leave the account there.
Yeah, and so that may be more effective than archiving that someplace, preserving that someplace on-premises.
Right. If somebody's already, and another question that I saw, which I thought was a good question, if somebody's got a local archive already,
mm-hmm.
They've got some third-party product and they've got an archive, is it, should they move that to the cloud? Should they keep it in the archive where it is?
Great decision. We actually have some options around that, so there's some things they can do. Sometimes you have the IT administrator that spent $16.5 million building out this huge
yep.
archive.
Mm-hmm.
There's definitely a need to keep that. There may be a financial implication to getting rid of that. So with that, we can continue to journal to that. So as you move users into the cloud, you can set up SMTP journaling and push that journal stream back to their on-premises archive. So they could preserve that if they wanted. There's also services to take that archive data and move it up into the Exchange Online archive. Not the most, depending upon how it's done, it can be not the most cost-effective way to do it. So the moving data is always expensive if you're maintaining some of those meta tags about the data, because you want to keep that preserved information.
Right.
The other option is just to drag and drop, right? So if they're using it just as a personal storage area, mm-hmm. There's some, traditionally some of the archive vendors, what they would do is, mailbox storage was expensive and archive storage not so much if you go back 2 or 3 years. Mm-hmm. So they would use this concept of stubbing, where you would keep just a header for each file in your mailbox. It would keep your mailbox size very small, but then you'd have all the data off in your archive someplace. For those types of users, you can restore information into the mailbox, go through the migration process that Naomi talked about, and then you can all have all that in the cloud. So not a simple answer,
okay, sorry. And then one other question about legal hold before you move on, and that is a legal hold, I mean, is it forever, or is there a default time that we're holding something for? If I put somebody's mailbox under legal hold, I mean, is that if we don't delete any mail until the hold comes off, or
see,
what actually happens?
You got to ask me a question that doesn't have an "it depends" for the answer.
I was in consulting too. I know every answer depends.
We'll talk about that a bit more, but okay. Short answer is legal hold is binary; it's on or off.
Okay.
But you can set different retention periods with something called single item restore. It's
cool.
A different use.
Okay. Good answers.
All right.
We'll let you go on.
So let's talk about that archive experience. When you set up this personal archive, it is exactly like a PST file, except that you configure it as an IT administrator in the console. So you go in and you set up an archive for a user. At that point, it just shows up in Outlook and Outlook Web Access. So as a user, they don't even have to log off and log on. Just all of a sudden in their folder tree, they will see another file in there. I'll show you that in just a second.
Okay.
Automatically discovers it. And then you can also set that up. Some of your administrative policies can automatically move mail from the main mailbox into the archive. So if there's specific timelines or policies where after 2 years or one this certain project, you want data to go to that archive, you can set those up to automatically move as well. Like I said, the IT pro experience managed through the Exchange Control Panel. Very simple to set up. You essentially just click a button and it turns on. You want to manage each archive must have a primary mailbox. So kind of to your point, if you delete the mailbox, the archive isn't just going to sit out there in space. It needs to be associated
sure.
with the mailbox.
Okay.
So let's move out to my first demo here.
I've seen a couple of questions come by around Sarbanes-Oxley. When you talk about compliance, do you address that one specifically?
We can definitely talk to that.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. I won't get ahead.
So you should be seeing my desktop here, right? This is I'm the administrator of my site.
Yep, we can see that.
Unlike Naomi, not a cool name like Squeakers or Sneakers.
Sneaks and...
So what I want to do is go in and manage Exchange. So we'll expand that. And that'll come up. And we'll go in here and... So you see I already have an archive set up, but Heinz here, part of my organization, doesn't have.
Heinz Ward works for you now, huh?
Yeah, he's part of the crew. So it's very simple. You go into Mailbox Features and then open up Archive and say Enable. And literally, it'll come up and allow you to change the name of what you have there. You say Save. Click on that. Save on this. And now Heinz, operating his mailbox, automatically has a new folder as an archive.
That easy, huh? He's got an archive now.
Yep. So now I am logged on as myself here in Outlook, and of course, as you saw in there, I already have an archive. So over on the lower left-hand side, you see an archive that is set up.
Mm-hmm.
Looks just like a PST file or another data file that you have associated there. It's separate from my main inbox. Now, what I'm not doing here is I am not having this go out and basically auto-archive my information. So I don't have a policy set for this mailbox where after a year or after 2 years, it automatically pushes data to the archive.
Okay.
If I'd done that, it would take my mailbox structure here. You see there's a personal folder and a mm-hmm. projects folder within my inbox. It would take that structure and rebuild it in the archive.
Okay.
I've just gone ahead and created a couple folders, 2009 and 2010. So now as an end user, I have this structure set up. I'm getting mail back and forth. There's information going on. So how do you search across that, right? Because it doesn't do you any good if you have to set up 7 different search queries and figure out where you
need
to
try to get through
it,
everything,
right?
Yeah, find everything everywhere.
So the scenario I have here is we have this event at Microsoft called the Mid-Year Career Discussion.
I'm familiar with it.
And so I'm going to search and understand that there is something around mid-year career discussion. There was an email that came out a couple of years ago that I was really interested in. So I go and look at this, and well, you know, there's a couple things right here in my mailbox, but that's not what I was looking for. So in the search tab, I can say, well, maybe it's one of these subfolders. So this, if I click on subfolders, it'll go to the, it'll access all the subfolders here.
Okay.
And what it's finding is there's something that had NYCD in it, but it's a different issue. That was just out of my projects folders. And
not the one we were looking for.
Not what I was looking for. So I'm going to go to all Outlook items. And now it will go through and search everything in the tree, including the archive. And
that's,
go
in that seemed pretty fast. That looked like a fairly quick trip.
That was very fast. It's pre-indexed. The search within Outlook pre-indexes all these issues and then scopes it depending upon how you're searching.
Okay.
So I can go in here. You see I have the 2009 folder, 2010, and then everything in my inbox, and then subfolders underneath. So it really gives you that capability to search across all of those. You don't have to do anything special about looking in one versus looking in the other. But it also allows you to search just in one area if that's what you're looking for as well. So let's jump back to the live meeting.
I didn't see anything in the, I didn't notice it in the admin UI. Is it possible to have multiple archives associated with a mailbox?
No, you're going to set up one archive per mailbox. So you're really limited to one. But you can do all sorts of folder implementation. And if you're on that extended archiving plan, then you can, it's essentially limitless storage. I believe the legal people have some word in there.
There's
around
actually
unlimited,
a real word there, but effectively.
So what you're looking at there is you can build different folders and projects and tree structures under that.
The question is really, I think people are really trying to figure out what the best practice is when people leave the company and we need to hang on to their mailbox. You know, do we just keep it in an archive? And again, just do we keep the account there disabled and just let the mailbox hang out there? But then I'm not sure what the licensing looks like in that case.
Right.
Do we still have to pay a license for it or not? So
I would say some of that, and you know, being the consultant inside me, is saying some of that depends upon the governance within the company.
Okay.
So if you have a policy that you have to retain every end user that leaves the company, you have to retain their mail for 6 months or 9 months, then yes, leave that account disabled but alive, right? And that'll retain all that information. If you have a shorter period of time and to the financial question, you'll probably be paying for that account for that period of time, for that license for it. But if you have a shorter period of time, then you can go through the normal purge that we have. Honestly, I work with a lot of customers that don't have a policy, and so in their on-premises environment, stuff just kind of hangs out there.
Yeah.
Maybe this is an opportunity to enforce that as well, because there's a financial tie-in to a governance issue.
Okay.
So we kind of showed this, right? Specialized mailbox, you see down at the bottom, this is Bob Kelly's online archive, looked just like mine. Drag and drop, you can move things between those folders and create those customized folders. So the experience is identical to what Outlook is or what Outlook Web Access is. And users interact with it just like any other folder in their system. I think we went through and demoed part of this, which is really just about how that's in the hierarchy, how you can read and reply to those mails. So if I'm looking at a piece of email in my archive, I can just turn around and reply to that. I can forward that. I don't have to move it into my mailbox before I do that. It acts just like
it's
a normal
live mail.
Part of the mail.
Okay.
Yep. And then if you have conversation view, I don't know, there seems to be lovers and haters of conversation view, and I go back and forth. If you're one of those people that lives and dies by a conversation view, that will work within the archive as well. So you can actually scope the conversation view. The initial view, when you click on a message, it'll show the conversation within the archive or within the main mailbox. And if you expand that, just like you do in normal conversation view, it'll pick things up from everywhere. So you can have that combined.
And when I'm working in Outlook, so I've got my OST file that's on my normal mail, is the archive included in the OST, or when I'm hitting the archive, am I going back to the cloud for that?
No,
we cache it at all.
You are going back for the cloud, right?
For the archive that sits in the
for
cloud.
For the archive,
okay.
It sits in the cloud. There is nothing in the OST file, and it is online access only. That's a key point. So if you're on a plane, and unfortunately or fortunately, 80% of the planes have Wi-Fi access now, but you don't have that bastion of not being connected.
As long as you're overland,
that's
in
right.
The U.S. Yeah.
But if you're not connected, you're not going to have access to the archive.
Okay. That's a good thing to know. Okay.
So we talked through search and how that scopes out all the advanced capabilities as well. So it is just a standard part of your mailbox. So to the question you just asked, perfect timing. It is online access only, right? Okay. It has to be Outlook and OWA, and you have to be connected. There's no additional client access or configuration needed. During configuration, there's nothing special that has to happen, but the configuration is just normal. So you're going to access that through your primary location. So you're not going to go in and set up auto-discover different to get your archive. It's all going to be where that primary mailbox is. And then this bottom note, there is a patch for Outlook 2007 to allow access to the archive. Okay. It's native within Outlook 2010.
Okay. Do you know, is that patch included in the when you run the desktop setup for Office 365?
I believe it is. The intent was to have it included in there. Okay. I haven't seen for sure whether it's in the release right now. And then just the archiving is a per-user feature, so this is something like you saw. I had one user already configured and added this for poor Heinz because he's going to get so much mail now that he won last night. So you don't have to license everybody for the archive. It can be a subset of users. You can actually, and you can take users, so if you wanted to move people between plans, you can also balance that load among your users as well.
Okay. Do we archive just messages, or does it archive calendar, contacts, Outlook folders?
Everything that essentially goes in and out. So what you're looking at is messages, calendar items, meeting notices, those types of things. Your contacts typically are not archived, but you could create a folder out there and move them.
Okay.
And I think we touched on this, that we need that rich coexistence, or hybrid as it's now called, for the standalone archive. So if you're continuing to maintain Exchange on premises, you just want the archive in the cloud, then we're going to need that hybrid model set up.
I actually got two different questions about Outlook 2011 for the Mac. Has it got archive support?
That is a fantastic question. I don't know the answer to that, but we can find out.
We'll work on that one. We'll get somebody to answer that one. Okay.
All right, so now let's move into preserve policies, right? So if you think about the fact that now we have an additional location to mm-hmm. keep data, so we have the main Exchange mailbox, we have the personal archive. So now what are we going to do with that? How are we going to apply policies to that and make that work? And that's really the concept of retention and preservation policies. So there's some, again, we run into the word archive here, right? So if you look at archive policies, that's how, basically on a time-based criteria, so after a certain amount of months or a certain amount of years, we're going to take some action on email in a certain folder or specific emails themselves. So this is that concept of how we used to have an auto-archive to back stuff up to a PST file on a regular basis.
Right.
Same concept happens, but we can just push it into that cloud archive. And then retention policies are more around how long do we retain things? So maybe it should be anti-retention, but it's retention policies, right? Is there, after a specific period of time, do we delete things? On that time-based criteria, do we move them someplace? Do we make them expire after a certain point in time? And one of the key points is retention policies will stay with those items as you move them around. So if I have a 2-year retention policy, I'm supposed to delete something after 2 years in my primary mailbox. I move that into the archive, it's going to continue to have that tag.
It honors that.
Yep.
Okay.
And then, of course, you can combine these. So you move things after a certain period of time, and then you delete them after the next tag hits. Now, as you look at how we move, delete, and manage retention, there's this concept of tags. If you're familiar with Exchange 2007, we had an idea of managed folders, where each folder had some information about it. We can still apply this concept of tags into folders, but it's really maintained on an item-by-item basis, so it gives you a lot more control. You take a default tag, which is if an email item has no other tag associated with it, then the default tag will apply. So maybe your company has a default tag that says don't do anything. Maybe your company has it set up so after 2 years, everything's moved to the archive just for mailbox management issues. Whatever, there's this default tag that you define.
Okay.
Then you specify a series of other tags. So that you name the tag, you specify the action. Is it a move tag? Is it a delete tag? What is the action you want to take on that item when something happens? And then you define the time period. Is it every month? Is it every 6 months? Internally, we set a lot of policies where By default, after 2 years, we delete things unless you change that tag. And then you can have other tags, like after 6 months, if it's in this folder, we're going to delete things. So after 3 months in this one. So you create those different retention tags. And then you bundle a bunch of tags into a policy. And you can apply different policies for different groups of users. So if you're in the HR department, maybe you have one set of tags associated with you. But if you're an engineer, there's a completely separate set of tags of how you work with your email. So again, you have a default tag, which is what, if nothing else applies, this applies across your whole organization. You have a set of different tags that you can apply that are customized for different things. And then you bundle those tags up into different policies, and you apply policies to people.
All right.
So message retention. Basically, this concept of a move policy, where you automatically move mail into the archive. Keeps your mailboxes under quota, right? That's with 25 gig mailbox, maybe that's not as important anymore, but you have to realize some people use this in that cross-premises mode as well. Mm-hmm. So if I have an on-premises exchange environment, maybe I don't want to put a huge mailbox down there. Maybe I only want to carve out 200 megs for my users and then use these tags to move to either the archive that the customer runs themselves or into the Exchange Online archive.
Okay.
Then the delete policy, same idea, but this is really around governance. If there's a policy that your company has defined that says you won't keep mail at longer than 90 days except for specific projects, then you can apply this policy and everything will be deleted according to that policy. Now, if you ever get under a legal injunction or a lawsuit, there's always this discovery that happens where people dig into the email.
Right.
And so if you have a policy that's specific and you have a way to enforce that, now if you don't have mail older than that, that's not discoverable because it's deleted, you have a policy defined.
So, okay.
I think there's one key point on here, which is that the per item policies take precedence over the folder policies. So if we don't already have that question, we probably would have had in the moment. So if I have a folder that's set up, by default, everything gets deleted after 2 years. Actually, let's go the other way. By default, everything gets deleted after nine months.
Right? Okay.
So that's my company policy, everything gets deleted. But I'm working on a special project, so I want to tag these items to hold them for 3 years because there's data that I'm going to need for the next 3 years about that. Then I set that item level tag for those items, and it takes precedence over what the general policy is. with the basically, when you have these policies applied, so you have the IT goes out and provisions what the different policies are. You have these different group policies. And then as a user, you'll see both the default ones that are applied into the folder structure or into your mailbox as a whole. And then as a user, you'll have the ability to go in and tag things. And you can tag it. What you're looking at right here is if I'm a user and I go into configure folders through my view of the Exchange Control Panel, then I can go in and set those. You can also tag them on a specific item-by-item basis.
Okay.
Which is what you're seeing right here. So in Outlook, you're going in and on the left-hand side, you're setting a folder policy. So I'm picking between the policies there and what the actions are. And then on the right-hand side, you'll see, okay, I've received an email. I'm setting it to a specific retention tag for that. So the retention policy says partner negotiation for 5 years.
Okay.
And then one of the really nice parts about this is that down in the bottom right-hand corner, every email will have an expiration date, so it'll actually show you when that email is going to expire. So it's not just kind of set it and forget. Every time you look, it'll actually pull up and tell you how long that's going to last.
And is that reset every time the mail gets modified, or is that?
No, it's a policy set based upon when it's created/received. So
okay.
it's not an as modified policy.
Okay.
Just one of the ways I use this is we obviously have large groups of email lists where we get lots of data circulated amongst our different teams.
Right.
And so for many of those technical groups, I have a folder that's set to 6 months, because if it's older than 6 months, it's probably out of date.
Probably changed. Yeah.
That's right. Quick comparison of message retention, which is kind of our 2010 style versus 2007 with managed folders. I think I talked to this a bit, but managed folders was really, there's a wide spectrum of what people want to do with retention. Managed folders applied to, here's a set of folders, maybe your inbox has one policy, and then the subtree of folders has other policies.
Mm-hmm.
But you couldn't do anything on an item-by-item basis. And what we found is that users, don't really think about email that way. Well, some do, but not all users think about it that way. Many users will actually look at specific items and hold them in one big folder or do something like that. So with the retention policies in 2010, you're much more flexible. You have the ability to classify folders, but you also have the ability to do it on an item-by-item basis. real quickly, so the policies are managed, basically, they're usually managed where the mailbox is. So if you're in a hybrid mode, you're going to have multiple sets of policies. You'll need to set them on premises and in the cloud. Which leads us to the next question, how do you migrate mailboxes that have policies set? They're not automatically migrated into the cloud, so your policies as you go through a standard migration won't have those tags applied. So we've created some scripting to help out with that. The first script, you go out and you actually export the tags in that mailbox, puts it into a nice XML file, go ahead and migrate the mailbox to the cloud, and then you can import there's another script to import those tags back in. So everything will be set the same once you migrate through that hybrid environment.
Okay, that's how I keep that's how I keep the policies across
every bit. Absolutely.
Now you mentioned that if I put archiving or policies on a particular item, then those are honored even if those are moved to another folder. Is that also the case if I move it like to a local PST, or is it only as long as it stays in Exchange?
No, it'll still be honored in that local PST file, so you'll still have those policies. Now, if you take an item and you're not associated with Exchange anymore, so if you copy and paste information out of that and put it in a different document, well, obviously it's not going to be able to retain that. But the item itself will follow the policies applied to it.
Gotcha. Cool.
All right, legal hold. So now we have this concept of I have a user who's under injunction, there's something going on, I need to actually put them on legal hold. So this is more of what, if you look at traditional legal retention archiving, there's this concept of personal archive, and now we're moving into really legal retention archive. So I need some immutable storage, something that the user can't go out and change. That will stand up in a court of law that says, yes, this is all the information
the
user has.
This is really what Gus said.
Right?
Okay.
And so we've added this ability to do what's called a legal hold. And you put a user on legal hold, so like we talked about earlier, it's binary. They're either on hold or they're not on hold. Their workflow looks exactly the same. They have a notification that they're on hold, but other than that, they can still work along in their inbox, they can work in their personal archive, they can delete things, they can actually go into their deleted items and empty their deleted items. So to them, everything looks the same. But on the back end, Exchange isn't actually deleting all that stuff. And it's still searchable, it's still available for people that are doing the discovery work. So you don't have to modify what the user does. In traditional legal retention archiving, somebody would be put under injunction, and they'd say, okay, give me everything that's in the mailbox, and we'll take it off in another system and purge through it and figure it out. And by the way, don't delete anything, right? But there was no control of that. So now what we've done here is we've actually given the ability so they can just operate on, and it still doesn't work. Again, very simple setup. And so I was actually going to walk through. Let's get it on the right desktop.
I'm gonna switch over, okay.
Yep. Switch.
We've got about 10 minutes or so.
So we'll do this real quick. Same kind of concept. You go into Manage in Exchange.
Does a user know when they're under legal hold?
So there's a couple answers to that. Right. Let's go into Al Davis.
Okay.
we're going to set him up with litigation hold on Al Davis. So now when you do this, when you hit Enable, right, you can put a note in here. And the note will be shown to the user of the mailbox. So if you're silent on this and there's no information on here, it's not going to be obvious to the user that they're on hold. But if it is, let's see here. You can put a note in there, and then also if you have an internal website that they refer to, you can put a URL in there.
Okay.
So you say okay, and now there'll be a pop-up that says it could take up to 60 minutes for this to occur, but within 60 minutes, anything that's in his mailbox and anything that's sent or received from that point forward will be preserved.
And where does that does he get that notification you just typed up as an email, or when, how will he?
He doesn't. So now you're looking at my mailbox, which unfortunately I'm not on hold. That would have been a great scenario there. But so if you go into the file in the backstage area, the account settings will be red, and it will have a notification in here that you're under legal hold, and then have that note that I typed in there as well.
Okay. So had you not put the note in, he would still see the red square here?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah. So there's not an active notification. He doesn't get an email, and the sirens don't go off that says, hey, you're under legal hold. But there is notification.
But he can see that he's there and switch to his Hotmail account instead.
Okay. Well, maybe. All right. So like we saw, turn it on with a checkbox there. You can go in and put a comment in the URL about how it works. And then, see, there you go. There's a picture of what it looks like. You see the little outline that says around account settings.
Oh, and it's actually still pretty subtle. It's not like a bright red. Yeah. It's just a little bit of a red frame.
And that's where the URL for more information and the information about the hold would be.
Okay. Now and that's because you provided that information. That wouldn't be there had you left it blank?
Correct.
Okay.
Yep. So, and again, you manage legal hold where the mailbox is. So if it's on premises, you're going to set that on premises.
Okay.
So now that there's another part of this legal retention archiving where I've worked with customers who are constantly in some form of legal hold for mm-hmm. whatever reason, and they're not happy with the binary function, right? You're either on hold or you're not. Yeah. Everything's preserved or it's not preserved. And so what they were looking for is more of a rolling type of hold. So I want to make sure I have the last 9 months worth of information or the last 6 months worth of information and nothing's deleted. We've seen other customers that look at this outside of the legal retention area and they just want to make sure they have this preserved corpus of data that they can go look at. So single item recovery, well, it was actually intended to hold things for kind of like an extended dumpster period, mm-hmm. can be configured to do this. So it's set on a user by user basis and it captures everything and holds them again in that period where the user doesn't see any different. They're going through, sending email, deleting it, moving forward. But the back-end system is holding them for a period of time. When you're deploying Exchange on-premises, it's off by default. In the cloud, it's actually on by default with a period of 14 days. Now this seems to line up with some of the retention periods that you guys have talked about earlier.
Interesting, so yeah.
We can extend that beyond 14 days with a service request. And typically, it's not recommended that you do beyond 1 year retention just because of the backlog that you're holding around that mailbox. Now, a single item recovery, this will apply against your mailbox quota.
Okay.
So that's, to the point that we talked about earlier, that's kind of a key issue there. As you're moving through looking at how big your mailbox is and what you're doing with that data, single item recovery issues. So if you have this set for a year, you're going to have a year's worth of data counting against that.
Okay. And that was a question I had around retention was, it appears deleted to me, but is it still counting against my quota?
Yep.
Okay.
Yes, that's true. All right. And then journaling, real quick. For that person that has invested in an on-premises archive and they don't want to move that or they don't want to have a split archive with some stuff in the cloud and some stuff on-premises,
yeah.
We can journal down to that archive.
And
we do intelligent journaling. So if you look at a typical message, you send it to 40 people in your organization. If you're journaling that for all four, if you're journaling everything for all mailboxes, you don't want to send that 40 times back down to your on-premises system. So we'll actually do that deduplication and only pull one copy of that message with all that metadata around who it was sent to, and that will be held and hopefully held in your archive in a smart way as well, not unduplicated back out. Real quick, we're going to talk about multi-mailbox search. I showed you about how you could search on your own mailbox with archives and not. Multi-mailbox search is very similar. It's a specific role that's covered through your RBAC or role-based administration
mm-hmm.
Tool. So you guys, I think you've talked about that.
A little bit.
So you can set up different roles for different users. By default, no one has this multi-mailbox search role within Office 365, so you'll have to go in as an administrator and assign people to have this role, which makes sense. You don't want any user being able to look through all the mailboxes.
Right.
So you go out and you basically do a search against all the different mailboxes. You can scope that to a specific set of mailboxes. That search data is then pulled back and put into what's called the discovery mailbox. So you'll see information come back that matches your search terms, is put into that discovery mailbox, and then you can work in that mailbox, you can do some analysis there, or you can export that down to a PST if you want to add it to a case management tool or something like that.
Okay.
Couple screenshots of this. You have the standard search criteria. You can put mailboxes in scope. You can say all your mailboxes. You can have specific terms. And then over on the right-hand side, you'll see that it's going out to a specific discovery mailbox. So you're going to go out and do this processing, look at all what you're trying to target by that, and then pull that together.
Can you just go back on journaling, because we went over that kind of quickly. Yeah. I know a few people had questions about it.
Okay.
Just kind of go back over the retention duration options and the historical data upload.
So with journaling, and our concept of journaling is really providing that data to your on-premises solution or your system. So we will take, you can do a couple different levels of journaling. You can say with transport level journaling, you can look at specific users that you want to journal. So if I want to capture all of your email and all of my email, but not everybody else's, I can set some transport rules that then journal that off to your on-premises solution. Or I can do everything, right? I can just take the full SMTP stream of all mail going back and forth and journal that out.
Gotcha.
It's a point-in-time journal. So everything that goes basically through our hub transports gets sent through that journal stream. We are not going to do a guaranteed, basically, acknowledgement that you received it and make sure on every message we do that. We basically pour the stream down, and we assume that you can catch where it's coming to.
Cool.
Does that help?
I think so.
So let me go back to the multi-mailbox search. So this is actually one of the coolest parts of it, is you can do a preview. So you can go in and say, okay, I want to search all the mailboxes in my environment. I want to look for anybody who talked about wingtip toys and this specific term.
Okay.
And then you can say, well, I don't want to copy that yet. I actually want to do kind of a preview of that and get an idea of what it's going to do. And so you click the button here that says preview, and then down in that pane in the middle, it will actually show you how many mailboxes have that term in it, how many items it kind of approximates that you're going to have, and an assumption as to how long this will take. So
nice. If
you're going to bring back, you know, 400 gigs worth of data, that might be more than you want. Maybe you want to scope that a little bit before you do it. But it gives you the ability to really control what you're pulling back. Now we have a section on information rights management. It's not really archiving, but we're going to talk through it really quick. We can kind of cruise through a couple slides here because it fits into this compliance world. IRM, Information Rights Management, gives you the ability to protect documents. This is not an Exchange-only thing or an online-only
thing. It's an Office thing, yeah.
Right. It's all part of Office. So it allows you to control who reads your documents, control what they do with them. Can they forward them? Can they print them? Can they copy and paste them? All of those types of issues. So As you build this into your Exchange environment, you obviously want to add some of these controls. So without doing any type of integration with Exchange Online, you can still use rights management documents. You can attach them into emails. Exchange just won't know what they are. It's just an encrypted payload. So it's kind of like Federal Express. We're taking the box, we're shipping it someplace else, no idea what it is. So now there's some challenges with that, right? Maybe there's some benefits you can get with Exchange actually being able to tell what's in there. So we've built this concept of doing a key import. You take your rights management server on premises, and you can import that key. There's a simple configuration to actually import that key into Exchange Online. We keep it in our data center. It's in a secure area. All the other security policies apply.
Okay.
And all we do is we publish this into Exchange for your tenant to do some of the decryption work. So what does that give you? It gives you the ability to do specific transport rules. You can say if I'm getting any emails from my HR department or maybe to my HR department, I'm going to protect those. If my CEO is sending a message, anything that comes from him gets automatically protected for internal.
So, can you do it by file type? Can we do like file type blocking?
You can do it on Office file types, so we can look at those types of files.
Okay. I can't block MP3 files or something this way, really. This wouldn't be the way to do that.
Well, you wouldn't want to encrypt MP3 files. You probably want to just block them, which you can do with transport rules. Okay. But that's another session.
We did transports earlier. That's where you would do that at.
That's right. And then it also allows you to do a couple different things with Outlook itself. So Outlook, it allows you to have these rights management policies as things that users can apply. You get to see that in the messages themselves. You can also look at them through Outlook Web Access because we have the key, so we can decrypt items for Web Access as well. And then also, typically if you're journaling off to another, right, we talked about journaling, mm-hmm. this comes into play here as well. If we didn't have that key in exchange, we would just send encrypted data in that SMTP journal.
Get into the journal and
can't do anything with it, right? Yeah. It's just a blob sitting there. And so we will actually decrypt prior to moving things into that archive and journaling
gotcha.
It out.
Okay.
And then I think the key point is also that we'll encrypt them to do some of these transport level rules and decrypt them to do some of the transport level rule inspection, and then we'll decrypt it to send it on its way.
Okay.
And then there's just a couple scenarios in here and some of the policies that some of these different things apply to, right? There, you have ethical walls, and what you really have is transport rules to block mail between
people. Talked about that a little earlier, right?
I work
in acquisitions, you work in the, yeah, you're a yep. broker, doesn't, yeah, yep. I shouldn't be telling you some stuff.
So we can block that at a transport
okay.
level. Supervision is an archiving rule that allows, you know, people to look at things. You can do that, again, through transport rules. And then as you get into the privacy rules and HR policy, you can apply some of the things like the IRM support, but also some of those policies around how quickly you delete items, where you retain them, and how long you retain them for.
Cool.
So, and I think that is about it.
That takes us away. All right.
So we have some questions you want to talk through?
There's a few. Maybe can you just explain what journaling is for, how it differs from archiving, when you'd used one or the other?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's really about whether you want to retain data within an like the personal archive that Microsoft has or a legal hold, or whether you want to push that to a different archive that you're holding someplace else. So if you have an archive set up on premises, you would use journaling to get that information to it.
Okay. Okay, so good description of kind of journaling versus versus archiving. Another question here is, and it's not really an archiving compliance question, but maybe you can kind of help us with an answer to it. If I'm doing a simple cutover migration, maybe I'm on 2003, I don't want to have to put a CAS server in place, I just need to get the mail moved.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a way to push that? I mean, I guess I could drag and drop PST files across into the online accounts.
It depends on the size of that account, right? That's mm-hmm. one of the things that we've run into. If you're working with 20 or 30 users, it's manageable to take their data, put it into a PST file, activate the mailbox in the cloud, attach that PST file, and drag stuff in there. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's a valid way to move data. If it's going to take you more than a weekend to get through your user base, maybe not. Right?
Okay.
So it really, there are options there that are manual as well.
Okay. Cool. Well, we'll stick around here for a minute. If anybody has other questions that you want us to address, I think we've hit a bunch of them. Like I said, archiving was a pretty hot topic for us this week, and we had a lot of that come through.
You did have one question in there about SOX compliance and SAS 70.
We had a couple come around SOX, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, I would say we certify our environment. We go through a SAS 70 report. We do an we have an independent auditor come in and audit both the data center level and then the solution level itself. We're going through those attestations with Office 365 right now just because you have to be in operations for a certain period of time before you can do the audit. We've done that with BPOS S, BPOS Dedicated. All those solutions have gotten their SAS 70 Type 2 reports. And so we can provide that information about what we do, but customers also use our security policies and the process we go through, and they actually help that as part of their internal audits as well. So we can provide all of the security policies that we use and help our customers to actually maintain that on their own.
Great. Okay, this is specific archiving solutions, and do you know we got any relationships with any of the third-party archiving solutions in order to get those up into the cloud? Or
so I do know that there's. So let me answer that in a different way. I'm not
okay.
sure if it's the right answer or not. So there was an announcement that actually came out today. Good timing for this session. That we are partnering with a company called LiveOffice.
Okay.
And they do a cloud-based archiving solution that is a little bit more comprehensive into the true legal retention, multiple retention periods and some of those issues that we don't satisfy with the Exchange Online Archive. As you may know, we had a product called Exchange Hosted Archiving.
Mm-hmm.
We're moving that towards the Exchange Online Archive. And as that transition, there's maybe a couple features that fall out, so we've partnered with LiveOffice to pick that up as well.
Cool.
There's other vendors out there that provide services as well, and again, if we're doing an SMTP journal stream, it can go just about anywhere that can receive that.
Great. Okay. I'll put in one plug for tomorrow's sessions. Link Online and SharePoint Online are both going to be covered, as well as a session on deployments. So please, if you get a chance, drop back in again tomorrow. More good information, more subject matter experts. And I think with that, we're going to call it a day. Thanks for your time, Jeff. Thanks for coming by.